This is the spring edition of basic bioinformatics tool series being organized by Center for Bioinformatics in collaboration with Health Science Library. We're going to be doing an intro to Unix class today. The materials that I'm going to use for this class are available at this link. This is more of a landing page that is going to bring you up to this main page here, and these are some of the classes we have planned for this year. Eventually, as I go through these series, you will have materials available for the rest of the sessions. But for now, we are going to be looking at Unix, and it's the Unix part one today. Up at this level, I have some example files that we are going to be using today as well as in the session next time. So if you want to go into the slides part one, I have two things available here. One is a handout that we are going to be using for in the class today. You don't need to take notes because most of the stuff I'm going to be doing is in this file. You can basically download it for your reference and keep a copy for later use. And I have a few slides that I am going to be using. Those a copy of those slides is available here as well. All right, so my name is Hemant Kelkar. I am at the Center for Bioinformatics here on campus. My group provides bioinformatics, core bioinformatics research support for all schools of UNC Chapel Hill. That includes support for a lot of the commercial software that the UNC has site licenses for. You may have already, gotten to know my group through that avenue. In case this is the first time you are hearing about my group, the virtual home for my group is at bioinformatics.unc.edu. There's a lot of information about the different software packages that UNC has access to that you can look at afterwards. So what we're going to do in this session today is we are basically going to learn how to access your Unix account and how to log into a Unix server. We are also going to be talking about the file system and how to organize directories so that you can plan your work accordingly, classify it for easy access down the road. We'll also learn how to navigate the file systems, the commands that are necessary for navigating the file systems. And then in addition to that, we will be looking at some useful basic operating system commands that are either built into Unix or are small programs that you will find are generally available on most of the Unix machines. In the part two of this session, which would be next week, we will actually look at how to use cluster computing resources, and we'll actually do some examples using a popular program called BLAT, which is sort of like NCBI Blast, but it's a much faster version of sequence search alignment type application. So quick history for Unix, basically developed by AT&T in 1969, late 1960s, and luckily for us, AT&T chose not to patent it at that point, for whatever reasons. And that actually worked out pretty well because academic people picked on Unix pretty quickly, and it eventually became the basis of several operating systems, and some of the names up here are probably familiar to you. Linux obviously being something that you hear about all the time. Even Mac OS X, which actually happens to be a variant of BSD Unix, is a part of this Unix system as well. Mac operating system obviously does a really good job of hiding the actual command line from the end user if you so want to choose. So, but you do have to remember that there is a full-fledged Unix operating system available under the pretty GUI that people generally end up using. This is sort of an evolutionary tree of Unix that I picked up a copy of from Wikipedia. Somewhere in here, I believe it's this branch which represents the Mac OS X. But most of the major Unix-type operating systems are in this particular tree. Unix has the distinction of being able has the distinction of designed originally to be a multitasking, multi-user, time-sharing environment. So as you know, If you're using a PC or a desktop, you basically are going to be mainly the user that is using that system. So no one else can use it while you're using your laptop, for example. But in case of Unix, it was always designed so that multiple people could use the computer at the same time. It's sort of easy to forget that computers were really, really expensive, and they were really, really big at one point. And it was not very difficult, it was not possible to have a portable computer. So you essentially had to log into a computer that resided in some building across the campus. Now, in case of Unix, the heart of the Unix system is a program called kernel, which essentially, again, is a piece of software that takes care of managing our interactions with the system hardware, meaning we as an end user are generally interacting with the applications, but the applications in turn interact with kernel, which in turn allocates the right necessary resources in terms of CPU cycles, memory locations, disk storage. All of that is basically taken care of by the kernel itself. So the reason, as I said, computers were really big, and originally people actually had to have a hardwired connection where you actually had a line that linked a terminal that you were using. So this is actually not really the very first incarnation of how people interacted with computers. I mean, originally people had typewriter-like keyboards without a display where you actually printed each command out on a roll of paper, and that's how you interacted. So there was no graphical user display at that point. But then terminals obviously got introduced, and the terminals, as they were called originally, NVT100, happens to be a kind of a terminal, which was a basic black and white display that allowed you to interact graphically with the computer, is still sort of being used. So even today, what we are doing is we are now going to emulate the original terminal in software. So as we are going to access the Unix server, we are going to be using a software program that is emulating a terminal, a physical terminal as people used to use before. Windows obviously has a full command line terminal in it itself. There is, with newer versions of Windows, there is a powerful programming language called PowerShell that I'm sure a lot of you have not heard about, but it's basically used quite significantly by the system administrators for doing system administration tasks in an automated manner. And Mac OS X, obviously, as I said, has a full Unix-like terminal built in to the operating system itself. There are several free Linux distributions available. That's what I think you're probably going to be using. They are available for all kinds of CPU architectures, right from ARM to different versions of the x86, Spark, all kinds of RISC chips, you name it. If you wanted to try one of the simple Unix-like operating systems, I will recommend Ubuntu, which you may or may not have heard about. There are various different kinds of versions of Ubuntu available. And the thing that you can do with Ubuntu is, even with your Windows laptop, you can boot off of a USB drive or a CD, which has the Ubuntu distribution on it. And that way you can experience the full Ubuntu version without having to install it. So you're not really modifying your Windows machine. You're temporarily booting into a Unix-like environment by using what's called a live CD. And instructions for doing that are available at this website. There is actually a UNC-specific distribution of Linux that is supported on campus by ITS Research Computing that is available. It's called Tar Heel Linux, aptly. It's available from this link here. It's mainly meant to be used for CCI hardware, so the hardware that you buy through the CCI program. That includes both laptops as well as desktops. So if you, for example, had an older desktop in the lab that no one is not using anymore, you might want to try Tar Heel Linux on it. Tar Heel Linux is actually managed actively by Research Computing. They set it up in such a way that you can use your Onion account with this terminal, so it's all integrated in with the university systems. And it's pretty easy to use because it's locked down in terms of security. They have already put in all the right security restrictions that are required by UNC security policy. And there is all kinds of other distributions that are available at this link down here, which is at the iBiblio site. UNC actually hosts iBiblio as well. Things to note, and this is something you need to sort of burn in your mind. This is going to take a little bit of time to get used to, because especially if you have been using PCs or Macs for a while, there is no undo in Unix. So once you execute a command, at least when you're doing it on the command line, you cannot revert back. So for example, if you deleted a file by mistake, there is no way to bring it back if you were working on the command line. Now most of the Unix distributions now have some sort of GUI available. So you are going to get a trash bin, which will still allow you to recover a file that you may have deleted by mistake. But if you are working on the command line, you have to remember there is no undo. Unix is obviously case sensitive, so be careful about the way you type things. I think that is pretty clear for most of the users now with the password policies that the UNC has, especially for Onion accounts. The biggest thing that I would have a recommendation for is stop using spaces. It's very easy, and both PCs and Macs allow it. People tend to put spaces in file names. You can do it in Unix. It's not that you cannot do it in Unix. It is going to cause you some additional headache because space character is treated slightly differently, and you cannot always expect to press the space bar and have it register it as such. So I would recommend getting used to putting an underscore wherever you feel like putting a space. So put an underscore. Just get into the habit of putting an underscore in giving file names. There are some versions of Unix-like operating systems that used to have file versioning, meaning if you were editing a file and you made a change, the time you save the file, the older version of the file was automatically saved with a different name. VMS was one of the operating systems that had that feature. Unfortunately, that feature is no longer present in the current set of Unix systems that you're going to be using. So if you make a change and if you save the file with the same name, you basically essentially ended up overwriting that older file. So for important data, especially for example, if you are editing a next generation sequencing file for whatever reason, just make sure that you have a good backup of that file somewhere before you try editing something, because mistakes happen, you know, this is Murphy's Law. So you have to be careful about things, just as with other operating systems.